morning, if you would, join with me. We're going to get into the Word of God in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. So I invite you to take a journey with me through Scripture. We're going to look at a few verses 7 through 10 in 2 Corinthians 12, where the Apostle Paul is writing there to the church of Corinth. And as he's speaking there to the church of Corinth, he's speaking specifically about a struggle in his life. But I believe that that which Paul was enduring, that which Paul revealed here in this 12th chapter, is essential to you and I, because we are a people who are well acquainted with struggle. We are a people who knows what it is to be under a trial and to experience it, the challenges of life. So I want you to hear from the Apostle Paul, and then we'll see what God has for us from these words of his servant. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 through 10, the Apostle Paul begins. And he says, "And unless I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And he, that being God, said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast of my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" I invite you to join with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we pause for a moment, we linger before your throne of grace once again. Father, we welcome your presence in this room. Father, it is such a refreshing moment to come into a time of worship when you look around and you see on the faces of people the exuberant attitude of meeting with God. And Father, there is this joy in the presence and the company of other believers as we lift up our voices together into you. Father, I can only imagine even now that, Father, if we were to just pull back the curtains of heaven and to peer there into glory, we would see that we are joining with the many there around the throne of grace who likewise are lifting up their voices, praising you, our great God and King. Father, we count it a privilege to be called your children today. And Father, I ask that, Father, you would speak to every heart that is gathered here. That, Father, as they sit under the authority of the Word of God, that, Father, their hearts might be pricked by your message. That, Father, you would speak into the very chambers of their heart, calling them forth to make decisions for you. And so, Father, I pray that you would use me as your instrument, your conduit this morning, to declare your truth. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, friends, I'm going to ask a little audience participation. I did this in the first service. They did a really good job with that. So the bar is set really high. So I want to invite you to participate with me at the very onset of this sermon this morning. And hopefully you'll see why as we get into the message this morning. But I'm going to ask if all the Christians in this room would please stand up. So as you look around this room, it's a room apparently filled with believers.
Praise God.
Amen. Those who know and love Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord. All right, would you have a seat for a moment? All right, here's the second test, the second exercise I have for you. At this time, with all the perfect people, please stand. Now see, in the first service, a wife stood on her own and the husband kind of had this bewildered look. In this service, the husband is prompting his wife to stand. You know, the reality is, and the simplicity of this exercise is this. In this room, we are gathered together with likewise people who have the same heartbeat, people who have been washed in the blood of the Lamb and who call upon the name of Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord. But one thing you may have seen and witnessed, and I hope that you saw, was that all of these people who had that one thing in common, that they're all part of this body of believers, also have something else in common. None of us are perfect. There's not a one of us in this room today who is perfect. None of us walk on water. None of us turn water into wine. None of us bring the dead to life. You know, we're not perfect people. And as imperfect people, we rely upon the grace of Almighty God day in and day out to face the challenges of this life. And let's be real. This life is challenging. There are days that you really just want to throw the towel in. You know, as I think about, the beginning of the school year right now, I had the opportunity to lead a teacher convocation on post for all of the teachers at Fort Rucker and to pray over them and to welcome God's presence, into their hallways and their classrooms and all the different meeting areas, pray that God would give them a blessed year. I know a lot of teachers, you're going back to school this time of year and you've had the summer off and you kind of recharge the battery. It probably didn't take very long for you to say, oh my goodness, I've got that kid again? Oh my word. And it won't be long for you to feel like, I'm spent. And we are broken people, and at times we face very real difficult challenges in our life. As we look at the Apostle Paul this morning, friend, he understood that. And here in this passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he was facing a very thorny moment in his life. And friend, I want you to know this, that God wants to use those thorny moments in your life to determine your trajectory. That God uses these to enable you to shoot the right azimuth, to be on the right plane, to go in the right direction. God uses these for the glory of His name and the uplifting of His kingdom. And friends, I hope you see that this morning in the Apostle Paul's life. Because God took this very messy situation in the Apostle Paul's life and He turned it into a very beautiful message for His kingdom. And that's exactly what He wants to do with you and me. And so, there are four things that I want to share with you this morning from what the Apostle Paul wrote here in 2 Corinthians. And the first is this. If God is going to make this mess of my life into a message, the first thing that we have to realize is this, my friends. It's okay to have a thorn.
Amen.
It is okay to have a thorn. Look at what the Apostle Paul said here in verse 7. He said, "And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations." Look at what God gave him. "A thorn in the flesh was given unto me." A messenger of Satan that God permitted into Paul's life to buffet him. "Lest I be exalted above measure." Twice there, the Apostle Paul says, "Lest I be exalted above measure." The idea is that God used what was going on in Paul's life, this thorn in the flesh that was given to him to humble him, to make him low. Now, friends, I don't know about you, but when I think about the Apostle Paul, I think that this is one of the greatest men outside of Jesus Christ, who's both man and God, but this is one of the greatest men ever to walk the face of this planet. That God used the Apostle Paul in such a powerful, such an amazing way to transform this world in which we live. God used the Apostle Paul to write over 2/3 of the New Testament. God used the Apostle Paul to evangelize the majority of the known world because, let's face it, the gospel was pretty much centered around Jerusalem and around that area up until that point. And yet God called this man, this persecutor of Christians, He set him aside, He washed him up, He saved him, and He sent him out. Amen. And God used him to bring the message of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles all around the world. And so as I look at the Apostle Paul's life, I'm saying, well, what does this man need to be humble about? Was there not a more humble man than the Apostle Paul? Yet God used this thorn in the flesh to humble Paul. Now, we can debate what that thorn is. It's really not important this morning because I don't think we're going to get to the bottom of it, because theologians have been debating this for a long time. Some say it was a physical ailment, maybe his eyesight or something else going on. Others said it maybe some difficult people that he was living with, but whatever, you know, that he had in his life. But whatever it was significant enough that God used it to humble him. And friend, how many of us know this morning that at times God allows certain situations, difficult, thorny moments in our lives to humble us? Friend, I know this. I have seen it. I have walked it. I have lived it. And it's not something that we tend to welcome into our lives. We don't go looking for it. But God, you know, God sometimes permits these things into our life. I've got a buddy of mine, I shared it in the first service, a buddy of mine that we served together on staff at a church, and he was there for about 10 years. You know, in June of 2014, I got a call from him while I was over in Korea at the time, and he called me up to tell me after 10 years at this church that we had both served at certain points during our ministry, because at one point he was our student pastor, another point he was our pastor of education, but we had served together over a 10-year period at this church, that he called me up and he said, Joe, you're never going to guess what happened. I said, well, what's going on? And he said, you know, I was let go today. I'm like, what do you mean you were let go? He said, well, you know, we've got a new senior pastor in, and he's been here, you know, no more than 6 months, and called me in. Here it is, Monday. He called me in and said, we're letting you go. We don't need you here anymore. Not just him, but others as well. And I said, well, was there something that you did? Did you do something wrong? And he's like, no, there's no accusation of any wrongdoing or anything like that. All he told me was that I didn't fit his vision for the church. And so here's this friend of mine who has not been accused of doing anything immoral, illegal, anything that violates Scripture. He's part of a church that is growing, that is booming. I mean, it is just overflowing at the seams, busting out the seams. And yet he gets this call just out of the blue to come to the pastor's office, and boom. His feet are swept out from under him. It's like a punch in the gut, literally taking out all the air in the room because something he didn't expect. A thorn in the flesh sent there to humble him. You know, stripping away every bit of maybe who he felt he was, his ministry identity and you know, his pastoral identity and his identity as a father and a provider for his family. All these things are now attacked in this one isolated incident. And friend, I want you to know this morning, that God used that situation in my buddy Brian's life to humble him. And it's not that Brian had done anything wrong. It's that God permitted this into his life. And God is using this in his life for his glory. And friend, I want you to realize something this morning. It is okay to have a thorn. Because we all have thorns in our lives. We all have thorny situations that come up. Maybe it's a relationship issue. You know, you're having a difficult time maybe in your marriage right now. And that's become the thorn in your life. Or maybe you're facing some financial uncertainty. Maybe there's been a change in your financial picture, and that's the thorny moment. You're wondering, you know, how am I going to make the mortgage? How am I going to take care of my family? How am I going to put groceries on the table? Maybe it's a physical condition that has been permitted into your life, and you find yourself saddled up under this. Friend, I want you to understand this. It's okay to have a thorn. You say, well, Pastor, that seems so counterintuitive. Why would a loving God permit thorns into my life? Well, friend, I want you to see exactly why God allows these things into our life. But before you see that, I want you to see this, that it's okay to have a thorn. But the second thing is this, that thorn might not ever go away. You say, well, that's a real kick in the face.
Boy, that's a happy message there, Pastor. Why don't you just close the Bible and we just finish right there? No. Hey, friends, it's okay to have a thorn. And some of these thorns in our lives, they may never go away. And don't elbow your spouse and say, I'm saddled with you. You're my thorn. No, I'm not talking that. But look at what the Apostle Paul said here. Verse 8. In verse 8, he said, concerning this thing, he's speaking of the thorn. He said, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. The idea here is that Paul is begging the Lord. I can almost hear him, saying, Lord, I've done all of these things for you. Lord, have I not been faithful to you? Have I not carried your message? Have I not been your water boy all around the world carrying the message of the gospel? God, look at what I have done for your kingdom. Look at what I have endured. I have been spat upon. I have been beaten. I have been imprisoned. I have been shipwrecked. I have received lashes. I have been left for dead. My family, my friends, they've abandoned me. And I've done all of that for you, Lord. And now you let this happen? Come on. Come on, God, why? I can almost hear him begging. Lord, why? My friend Brian, got unceremonially just dismissed from that church. He was perplexed. What? Lord, why? Is there an area of sin in my life, Lord? Have I somehow failed you? He prayed again and he sought the Lord vigorously, weeping before him. But we spent hours and hours on the phone praying and weeping together over this situation that he had no control over. Friends, it's okay to have a thorn. And some of these thorns, they linger on. Some of them are for but a season, but some of them may never go away. You may have a health situation that is literally stripping away your vitality. You say, why, Lord? I was such a healthy person. And now I struggle with the simplest of things. It might not ever go away. But friends, I want you to know there is good news. This isn't just a doom and gloom sermon. There is good news. There is hope for you and I. And the hope is found in this, that it's okay to have a thorn, and you know what? That thorn might not ever go away, but I want you to understand something about that thorn, and that's this. Focusing on the thorn is not the path to peace. Friend, if you focus all of your energy, all of your time, all of your efforts on that thorn, friend, that is not the path to peace. As we look at this passage, we recognize that Paul got an answer from the Lord. But that answer wasn't what Paul expected, but it was what Paul needed. Look at verse 9. In verse 9, again, it says, concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times. Oh, verse 9, sorry, not verse 8. He said to me, that's the Lord. The Lord said, my grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in weakness.
Amen.
Amen, that's right. God said, my grace is sufficient. My strength is perfect. Paul prayed to the Lord 3 times. Lord, deliver me from this. Release me from this thorn. But you know what God did? God didn't give Paul what he asked for. God did one thing better. God gave Paul the grace to bear up under it. Friends, some of the thorny situations in our lives, God's not going to immediately remove them from us. Because that tends to be the way we pray. I know that for a long time, that was the way I prayed when I found myself in difficult circumstances. Is immediately when I would fall upon my knees and cry out to the Lord, my first thing would be, Lord, deliver me. But as you read this passage, I think there's a better way to pray. There's a better mindset to have, and that is this, Lord, strengthen me. Lord, I've got this thorny situation. You know what? I don't understand why. Lord, I didn't invite this thorny situation in my life. I really don't want it, but it's a very difficult time in my life. I
It's here, and I have to live with it. Lord, give me the strength. Give me the strength to bear up under this thorn during this very difficult season, no matter how long that season may last. God said, my grace, Paul, is sufficient for you. And my buddy Brian, he's been in this journey now for over 2 years. That happened in June of 2014. We're now August of 2016. In that time, he has not had another full-time ministry call. He's had a lot of churches look at him. He's done some supply work and some interim work. But at the end of the day, there's this gap on his resume. It's hard to explain. In churches, all they do is they see that gap. And when they ask, he just says, well, you know, I was let go. I wasn't given a reason. This is the situation. He served faithfully. He was a wonderful brother in the Lord. But this is where he finds himself. But one of the things that he's learned in this journey over 26 months now is that God's grace is sufficient to meet this need. You know, in this 26-month period, God has opened many weird doors for my brother Brian. He's painted houses. And I say weird in the sense that for so long he was pastor. Not that there's anything weird about painting houses. But, unless you just don't like painting houses like myself. There's a lot weird about it. But, you know, God's had him painting houses. God's had him laying floor. God's had him doing different supply work. But in all this different time, over 26 months, you know one thing that God hasn't done? God never failed him and his family in 26 months. In 26 months, he hasn't dipped into his savings one time. In 26 months, he hasn't missed a mortgage note. In 26 months, his kids still participate in all the same activities they were participating in 26 months prior. In 26 months, God has shown up and shown off over and over again. The testimonies of how many times God has met their financial need in their lives. I was telling the service this morning, and he told me not too long ago, that a gentleman literally out of the blue showed up at his house. And this is something that happens on a regular basis, my friends, that has been happening over this 26 months. A gentleman literally showed up at his house. Said, I don't know you. I don't know why I'm here. But God told me, I was on my way out of town. God told me to come here. He gave me the address. I showed up at your house. And God told me to give you this $500 cash. Brian said it was the exact amount they needed to get to the end of the month. Over and over again, over 26 months, God has exhibited his grace to my brother Brian. My friends, is God not faithful? Is your God not faithful? God told Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. God gave Paul exactly what he needed. His grace, his presence, and his strength. Because he said in verse 9, he said, my strength, Paul, is made perfect in weakness. Friends, our strength is made complete in Jesus Christ. Because it's in our utter weakness, it's in our utter nothingness that we must learn to wholly depend upon the Lord. So, it's okay to have a thorn. And friend, that thorn may never go away. But the good news is that focusing on the thorn is not the path to peace. And the great news is this. Joy, my friends. Joy is certain. Even with the thorn. Friends, joy is certain even with the thorn. Look again at verse 9. Verse 9, at the end of verse 9, the Apostle Paul says this. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. He said, I will gladly boast in my infirmities. Who in here does that? Anybody? Do we gladly boast in our infirmities? When we're going through a trial, is that the first thing that we think of? When you're facing a financial or a relational or a social or mental or whatever problem you're facing, is the first thing you think of, thank you, Lord. Thank you so much for thinking of me with this very difficult time. I appreciate you loving me so much that my car broke down this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for blessing me with this unexpected bill. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that my health was stripped away, that, you know, I got this diagnosis today. Thank you, Jesus. We don't do that, or at least I know I don't nearly enough. When those trials come into my life, more often than not, I fall down on the ground, I fall on my knees, and I begin to cry and have this pity party before the Lord. Why, Lord? Like, come on, God. Why are you allowing this to happen? What did I do to deserve this? And I begin to sob before the Lord, as if God was not aware of my situation, the God who knows the end before the beginning. Right, as if I was enlightening him to my difficult situation. Yet Paul is illustrating to us that joy is certain even with the thorn, because he says, I gladly will boast in my infirmities. That I'm going to brag about the difficult things that God has permitted into my life, because God has got them there for a reason and for a purpose. And friend, I don't know what it is that you're going through, what struggle that you're facing right now, what thorn you may have in your side, but I want you to know this, God has that thorn there for a reason. And God wants to use that thorn for his glory. And that's exactly where Paul ends this passage right here in verse 10 when he says, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. He says, I take pleasure in these things for Christ's sake. See, that's the key to this whole passage. This whole passage hinges on three words. That everything that God permitted into Paul's life was for one reason and one reason alone. And that was for the glory of Almighty God. That God was going to use this thorn as an instrument to catapult Paul in the ministry that God had called him to. And friend, whatever it is that you're facing in your life, understand this. God wants to use that to expand his kingdom. God wants to use that to stretch forth the tent stakes. And I can hear somebody this morning saying, but Pastor, come on, really? I mean, you just don't know what I'm going through. And you're right, friend, I don't. And I'm not going to try to make light of what your situation is. The reality is your thorn, it hurts. And it's difficult. And it's a struggle. But the reality also is this, that God knows that thorn. And God knows you. And God wants to use that to make this messy thorn situation and turn it into a message for his glory. God has used my brother Brian in his situation in such powerful ways. You know, the opportunities that he has been given to preach at many different churches over this time. The opportunities when people see him and they're like, well, how are you doing? What's going on in your life? And he begins to share how God has orchestrated the events of this last 26 months. How he's met financial needs. How he's met physical needs. How he has supplied all of his needs, all of their needs according to his riches and glory, over and over and over again. Friend, what you're going through may just be the testimony that somebody else needs to hear that has a similar circumstance that God wants to use for his glory. So friend, as you look at this passage and consider what Paul is going through, it all hinges on those three words. The end state of this whole passage is that God permitted this thorn for Christ's sake. See, friends, God isn't concerned about my comfort. And God isn't concerned about my convenience. But God is concerned about my convictions and my walk with him. And friend, I want you to know this morning that there is joy in the midst of your thorny situation. And that God wants to use this to turn that what seems like a very tragic situation into a time of triumph for the kingdom of God. Because ultimately, that's what it's about, is advancing the kingdom of God for Christ's sake.